Howard and Wood have no idea what's ahead of them. And Wood is recommending to send in one lone brigade and see what success they have. Let that sink in for a moment. Hazen, who's right there hearing this, tries to argue this is a stupid freaking plan. And get this, you laugh. He's told to shut up by Howard. And Howard says, you will take that position and turn the flank if you have to sacrifice your brigade. Hazen terms this meeting and he casts a glance at one of his cartographers, Ambrose Bierce. Bierce sees this look and he knows that a criminal blunder is about to occur. Years later, Bierce writes a short story called The Crime of Pickett's Mill. Any questions?
Who is Howard's superior today?
George Henry Thomas. I mean the Cumberland, he made that.
And that's one of the best opinion.
And he's over at Brown's Mill off of the Dallas Airport. Ready to continue? Anybody falling asleep yet? All right. I like this without my notes. So at 5 p.m., oh, did you have a question in the back?
When you're talking about these flags over here, what are these two larger flags? Are they, that surely they wouldn't be carried out. I mean, they're
actually
huge.
Yes. So the two larger flags are federal flags, union flags. One is the national flag, one is the state flag. So
they're,
if you're
like
an Ohio regiment, the 49th Ohio, so that would be, you would typically carry two flags in the battle, if you're Union, of course. If you're Confederate, you have the one per regiment. But that's the Union flag, that's the difference in, I guess, the industrial capacity when they can afford to get their troops. So, yeah.
Maybe my group is the Irish Brigade, and is he meeting up with any of the Northern Irish Brigade?
Well, actually, the Irishmen that you're talking about are Lucius Polk's men in the cavalry. I'm sure, because America at that time had so many immigrants fighting the Civil War, I would not at least get docked down yet.
At Fredericksburg, they
yes.
Fight against
24th Georgia and the Mahar Brigade, Mahar Brigade. Mahar Brigade, as it's pronounced. Yes, that did happen there. You had Germans fighting Germans at Chancellorsville, the next battle, the Dedicated Battle in Virginia. Here at Pickettsville, you've got Scandinavians fighting Scandinavians. That's a fun part to talk about. We'll get there in a second, don't worry. Your ancestors went up. We have a descendant of and it's a guy that fought here at Gibson's Brigade. We'll get to Gibson's slaughter, fight in just a second. No offense, man. Howard's troops are lining up for the battle. It's 5 p.m. and Howard's trying to get the battle going. In the lead of T.J. Boyd's division is Brigadier General William B. Hazen. Now, I like to say of Hazen that he's a big fan of Georgia State Park's historic sites because he's at so many of them. He's here at Pickett's Mill. He's at Resaca, which is a historic site. There's no one there, nothing there, but it's owned by the state. And he leads the attack at Fort McAllister in Savannah. So Hazen, being a big fan of us, is here at Pickett's Mill as well. He's here to see the museum and visitor center, just like you guys are. And he leads the assault for T.J. Boyd's division of Howard's attack. Behind Hazen, 5 minutes behind as it should be, is Colonel William Gibson. Gibson's troops, here you go, sir. Gibson's brigade has two of our regiments on the Union side here at Pickett's Mill, the 15th Wisconsin and 42nd Indiana. 15th Wisconsin is made up of Scandinavians, but 90% Norwegians, the rest being Swedes and Danes. 42nd Indiana, maybe I should say it's fighting by 6th Indiana Regiment, that's a 4th German regiment. They're known as the 2nd German Regiment of U.S. forces, but they're also known as the 32nd Indiana because they're all from Indiana. So you have guys saying, hold a bullet, and then forgotten bottle line there in the ravine as they're fighting up. That's the second wave. That's Gibson's brigade. Behind Gibson's brigade is a third wave, a third brigade under Frederick Neffler. Neffler is a Hungarian by birth. Now, as the attack begins, Hazen and his brigade of 8 regiments, that's twice the size of a brigade typically, but they're all low-strength regiments, so he has an average-sized brigade numbers-wise. Hazen leads the assault. He has essentially a front line and a rear line in his brigade. You have 4 regiments in front, 4 regiments behind. And the first 4 regiments follow the low-lying terrain into this ravine, kind of like following a creek down. And they follow this ravine, and they're going, and the line behind them, the second line of Hazen's brigade, get lost because of the terrain of the ravine, because of the incredibly dense underbrush, the quote, thickest of jungles that Indiana guy talked about, they get lost. Instead of going into the ravine, they end up straying left and end up in a cornfield that accidentally flanks the Confederates here. Without even knowing it, they're winning the battle. But they're lost, they don't really capitalize on that. So with that being said, the idea is that Hazen rolls up the Confederate flank here and threatens the Confederate right and forces the Confederates to fall back to Chattahoochee River. With that being said, as the attack is beginning and Hazen is marching towards us, Claiborne has Gavon's brigade facing